All that shortly, but taking you straight across to the live briefing being addressed by the Ministry of External Affairs spokesperson.
Talks. India had concerns on Khalistani elements. So are these concerns now, in a sense, Islamabad has taken care of these concerns on Khalistani elements?
So, Siddhan, frankly, I have not seen the statement which has been made by the U.S. side, you know, in a, perhaps an extradition case in the U.K. What I can tell you is that the location of Dawood Ibrahim is not a secret. You see, time and again, for the last several years, I think we have been presenting to Pakistan a list of people who are in their country. We have asked repeatedly that he should be handed over. He is a UN-proscribed terrorist. His imprint on the Mumbai blast is very clear for all of us to see. And frankly, many people from the media fraternity, they have managed to speak to him, you know, and I think it is very clear that the linkages are in Pakistan. But, you know, I think when we look at this episode of his presence, and if we try to kind of see what Pakistan has been trying to convince to the international community on steps they claim that they have taken, you know, against terrorist and terror groups operating from their soil. Now, it's very interesting that you claim that you have taken action, but when it comes to taking action against the people who we have demanded, either you ignore, you go into a denial mode, you in fact even deny that they exist and they're present in your country. But on the other hand, you try to project to the international community, you try to hoodwink the international community that you are taking some action against the terrorist and terror groups operating from their soil. So I think this basically is a case of double standards. This is something where they stand completely exposed, you know, as far as their claim of taking action against terrorist groups in Pakistan is concerned. On the other issues, Siddhant, you know, on Kartarpur, right? You see, we had proposed a set of dates. Pakistan has agreed that they will come for the dialogue on the 14th of July. There are, of course, certain differences. We will discuss those issues as well. I think it is important for us to emphasize that this is a matter of sentiment. This is a matter of fulfilling the wishes of Sikh community. We have a commitment which we have made to them that we will try to ensure their passage to the Kartarpur Sahib in an easy, secure and free manner. We are working towards it. There are differences, as I mentioned. I think we will try to resolve those differences, you know, in the talks which are going to take place on the 14th. Reza?
Just another question on Pakistan. We had the reports, the statement issued by the counter-terrorism department of Pakistan's Punjab province yesterday about some 23 cases being registered, and Hafiz Saeed is named among the people who has been booked. I was wondering if this is enough, because this is just for terror financing. It doesn't address the larger concerns that we have about his role in terror activities.
No, Reza, I just answered. You know, let us not get fooled by these cosmetic steps. You see, I think we have seen the course of such convictions in the past. We have seen where it goes, where it is headed. Pakistan's sincerity to take action against terrorists and terror groups will be judged on the basis of their ability to demonstrate verifiable, credible, and irreversible action against terror and terrorist groups operating from their soil, and not on the basis of half-hearted measures, you know, sometimes which they undertake to hoodwink the international community. Our ask is very simple. We want a normal relationship in an environment which is free from terror and violence. Ji, Ranjit ji.
Has India also communicated to Financial Action Task Force regarding the presence of Dawood Ibrahim in Pakistan?
You see, I'm frankly As I mentioned earlier, that this is something which is a very old story. You know, I think we are talking about post-Mumbai blast. And time and again, we have emphasized, we have highlighted that Daud's presence in Pakistan and Pakistan's denial, I think it is something which basically exposes Pakistan. It basically shows that Pakistan is not very serious in taking action against the terrorist groups operating from the soil. I'm not specifically aware whether this has been communicated through FATF. Sridhar?
So in a written reply yesterday to Parliament, the India has made a scathing indictment of the situation in Balochistan and Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and Sindh, along with the condition of the minorities there. Is this sort of a departure from the... Because the last time there was a major reference to Balochistan was when PM spoke about it 3 or 4 years back in the during the Independence Day speech from the Red Fort. How would you see this? Because when other countries comment on... So we say that they do not have any locus standi. But we have commented on the happenings in their provinces. So how do you see this?
No, Sridhar, I think that we do not normally qualify a statement which has been made in the parliament. The statement has been made by a minister, and I'm not here to kind of qualify the statement which has been made by him in the parliament. Parikshit.
On the sidelines of the G20, when Prime Minister Modi met President Donald Trump, there were positive discussions both on trade and also 5G. Now, to take that meeting forward, has some sort of... Have talks begun with U.S. and will there be meetings now between Indian and U.S. diplomats on 5G issue and the issue of trade as well?
You see, I think... Again, I'll reiterate something which we have spoken in the past. You know, the broad trajectory of the relationship, it remains very positive. We have very deep convergences, you know, on a range of issues, you know, between India and the U.S. The discussion which Prime Minister had with President Trump on the sidelines of G20 in Osaka, I think it was very open and productive. Apart from the issues which you mentioned, we also discussed Iran. Trade, of course, got discussed. The bilateral defense relations were discussed. I think it is important to understand that in any relationship which is multidimensional, you know, like India and the U.S., there are bound to be certain differences. There are bound to be perspectives where we share a different approach. How we handle it is the key. And flowing out of that meeting, what we agreed was that on all these issues, I think we will continue to talk. On trade, Foreign Secretary did mention in his briefing that the two sides will meet very soon. And I understand that the trade ministry officials from the two sides are going to meet in the next couple of weeks. On 5G again, I think we made it very clear that it is not an issue of difference. It is an issue where we can work together with the U.S. We have technology, we have the market. We also have to see how we can work together as far as leveraging our individual competence in the area of these two things, you know, and also how we can perhaps work together under the banner of Make in India initiative. So we are looking at some of these issues also as a kind of an opportunity for the two countries to work together. Was there anything else related to this? 5G. So 5G I have mentioned. So I think we are looking more as an opportunity than as a challenge. You know. Yes, please.
Sir, American Senate has passed a bill giving India NATO-ally-like status. And it is also going to House of Representatives, going to be discussed. So did you expect and are you pushing for this ally-like?
No. So you see, I think it is a process within their system. But we do appreciate the widespread bipartisan support for India-U.S. strategic partnership in the U.S. Congress. which is reflected in the version of the National Defense Authorization Act bill passed by the Senate. We look forward to continuing facilitation from the U.S. Congress for defense cooperation, trade and technology partnership between the two countries.
Hello. This is on the EPG report, Nepal-India EPG report. Almost 1 year, the joint report has been finalized. It's because of the PM Modi's busy schedule. It's being reported also regularly in the media. What actually is the reason that it's been delayed for almost 1 year? Mm-hmm. And the second one is regarding the IFA awards, which was being supposed to be held in Nepal, and it is being cancelled yesterday for the time being. And there are some media report from the Indian media that it's because of the Chinese influence that the event has been cancelled. What's the MEA's official version on that?
No, I mean, second one, it's a very difficult one. I don't think I know this answer, but I don't think it perhaps pertains to my domain as well. You know, on the first one, on the EPG report, you are aware that EPG, the Eminent Persons Group, was set up in 2016 to look into the totality of India-Nepal relations and also to suggest steps and measures to kind of improve and expand the close relationship which we shared between the two countries. They met 8 times, 4 from each side. Eight members from 4 from each side, and 9 meetings have been held. The EPG is yet to submit its report to the government of India and Nepal. The report will be given due consideration by both sides once it is submitted.
The U.S. has designated the Balochistan Liberation Army as a terrorist organization. How does India see this action?
You see, I speak on behalf of the government of India. I speak on behalf of the Ministry of External Affairs. I do also speak on matters which pertains to the government of India. So this perhaps is out of the ambit for both, so I won't be able to comment on this. Ji, Gaurav.
Sir, 19th Commonwealth Foreign Ministers meeting honi hai. Usme kya India aur Pakistan ke foreign ministers ke beech koi meeting hogi? Kuch expected hai?
Pehle to aap ye puchhe ki hamare foreign minister ja rahe hain ya nahi?
हाँ, जा रहे
उसके बाद आप पूछेंगे दूसरा सवाल कि मुलाकात होगी कि नहीं
जी
तो पहला जो मेरा सवाल था उसका जवाब यह है कि हमारे फॉरेन मिनिस्टर जा रहे हैं विदेश मंत्री जा रहे हैं लंदन जाएंगे कॉमनवेल्थ फॉरेन मिनिस्टर्स मीटिंग को अटेंड करने के लिए जहां तक मुलाकात का सवाल है ऐसी कोई प्लान नहीं है दोनों विदेश मंत्री के मिलने के लिए मानस
Sir, it's been almost, in fact, over 2 months, in fact, since U.S. waiver to import of oil from Iran. So, in fact, what is the clarity, basically, sir? What is our stand now, actually? Do we have a stand at all, or, in fact, have we totally stopped buying oil from Iran? So, what is the status, sir?
No, of course, we have a stand. I mean, every time I have been repeating my stand from this platform. You see, it may not be easy for me to comment specifically on commercial contracts. Now, if you want to know the answer about the amount of oil which has been imported from specific countries, I think you will have to contact the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. But what I can share with you is that this matter did figure in the discussions, in the talks between Prime Minister and President Trump. We outlined our energy concerns. And if you followed what was shared by the Foreign Secretary. I think basically there are 3 broad principles under which we will function, which will be guided by stability, predictability, and affordability. So our decision on oil imports will be guided by these 3 factors. But overall, I think this will all dovetail into our national security. So this is the broad picture I can give it to you. Specific questions on the amount of oil being imported, I think you will have to address the concerned ministry. Geeta?
There's a question in Parliament regarding a molestation case involving an employee of the High Commission of Pakistan. And the response is with regards to the case that there was no police complaint filed. Are there any details on the case? Because this is regarding an employee of the Pakistan High Commission.
Is it something which came, which was up answered today in the Parliament?
Yes.
No, I think I'll have to get back to you. I don't have the details at this point of time. I don't see any other hand. Akhilesh ji.
Sir, reports say that takriban 550 crore rupee ka ghata ho raha hai Indian Airlines ko because of closure of Pakistani airspace. So, are you doing any effort so that the airspace be open for Indian flights or flights coming to India?
No, who are we to take such efforts? It was a unilateral decision by Pakistan to close their airspace. The decision to open their airspace has to be taken by them. Now, you are talking about the cost to us. I hope you are aware about the cost to Pakistan. So I think that you have to find out. But this is a decision which we have not imposed on them. I think this is a decision which they have taken. And they have to remove the restrictions. I think the ball is in their court, not in ours. Sinjoy.
So, in a few weeks, many duplicates will use the UPS in the airport.
All right, the spokesperson of the Indian Ministry of External Affairs, Ravish Kumar, briefing the media. A number of issues that he has touched upon, ranging from the outcome of the bilaterals that the Prime Minister has had at the G20 summit, also talking on the NATO ally-like status for India, but also reacting to the developments on the U.S.-Iran tensions and on importing oil from Iran, specifically on that, saying that they have taken a stand already, that India has made its stance absolutely clear, and also mentioning that the matter was discussed between U.S. President Donald Trump and Prime Minister Modi during the G20 summit as well.